Raise your hand.
I used to.
You used to?
There's souls there.
Yeah.
A lot of that.
So Denise, thank, go to the club if you want.
For some people, that's their niche, you know. That's familiar ground, and they've been there and they have come out of there. That kind of situation, what better person to go back, you know, to do it? If they feel strong enough to do it, some people can handle that. Yeah, so it just depends on the individual, everybody's different.
All right, well, we wanna get fired up. We wanna get fired up. You know, this is in my bones now. You know, I wanna see people saved so bad. I mean, I guess because when I, you know, began to, you know, try to give more of myself, it seemed like a hunger has really just kind of got over me. Amen. I just wanna see people born in the kingdom of God. So that's the reason why they show up on Sunday. I just try to grab somebody and get the name. And call them. Amen. Whoever invited those young men the other day, one is two of them. And amen, I couldn't wait to call them. You know, so this is our job. The Bible says that we were, let me see how the title said. He said we were created for, he said that, he had a good way of saying it. Titus 2. Maybe it's good, I can't remember. 2:14, who gave himself for us that he might redeem us from all iniquity and purify unto himself a peculiar people, zealous of good work. All right, zealous. All right, so. What does that mean? He created us a peculiar people so that we might be what? Zealous of what? Good work. What do you think that word means? Zealous, zealous, zealous of good work. All right, eager. All right, how many eager people do we have? How many eager saints do we have? How many eagle saints do we have? Amen. So God wants us to be what? Excited about this. Amen. So we need a little bit more enthusiasm and excitement. I think that we can pump ourselves up by what? Feeding on the word. Whatever prayers we need to pray, what? Just pray them. And I think that something will begin to what? Happen. Y'all believe it? Woo, glory to God. I'm just feeling good right now. Amen. Praise God. So, I've given you a little food for thought, and Galatians talks about, I'm not going to mention that pray, I pray that I travail in birth for you, I travail in birth for you until Christ be what? Formed. I travail in birth. All right, now anybody know anything about travail?
Every woman has had a child.
All right, what does
men may not, but women do.
Anybody know anything about travail? What does travail mean?
Oh, agonizing.
Okay, agonizing. So, just like a woman agonizing, giving birth, then we are to what? Agonize. Amen. For what? Souls to be saved and what? Souls to be formed after they get saved, established, made perfect, and completed the will of God. That's a prayer. We got to pray these things. Pray, that's prayer into existence. I want to see God using everybody. I want everybody getting happy a little bit more often. Amen. I just want to see Sister Mary Ann break down sometime and cry and run all over this church. And come on, amen, come down and you can give me a word. The Holy Ghost will work through it. Amen. Praise God. How many believe it's time for this?
Franklin. Amen.
Okay, Mr. Hill, got a question?
I was just thinking.
All right, now, in this lesson, we have all of these people that's interested in the laws. Okay, who's interested in the laws first? Y'all read all this? I mean, y'all haven't read it, been reading. Okay, so who's the first one that's interested in the law? You right? Amen, and we can quote a whole lot of what? Sunday school scriptures. To that effect, right? Who else is interested in the law? Jesus, right? Jesus what? Gave his life. Amen, he didn't. Amen, he gave his life. He said, I lay down my life for my friends. Nobody take it from me. Here in his love. Not that we love him, but he loved us. All right, who else is interested in the law?
The Holy Spirit.
Okay, who else?
The Holy Spirit.
All right, now, how is the Holy Spirit interested in the law? Okay, give me some things the Holy Spirit does that lets us know that he's really interested in the laws.
Sister Denise? That's one of his assignments in St. John. I believe it's a 14th chapter.
Okay. What does that say, Sister Denise? Can you read it out so we can hear it?
He gives the world sin, righteousness, and judgment.
Right.
So he is absolutely interested in the laws.
Right.
He actually convicts the world.
And he's interested not only in the laws, but he's interested in what? The body. Us too, right? And what does the Holy Spirit do to let you know that he's really interested in us? What does he do? A lot of roles he play, right? He's either what? Teacher, guide, what else?
Comforter.
And there's a whole lot of ways the Holy Spirit manifests his concern about the laws and men overall. Okay, who else is interested in the laws?
Angels,
okay, what do angels do? They are what? Ministering spirits. They're always, how many failed your angels today? How many know you failed your angels? Failed the influence of your angels. This morning I was here by myself, but it's really good when you're here alone. And here's what, this is what came to me. When I first hit the door, I don't know why this song on the way to church, and it really hit me when I began to get into this church. It said, God will make a way where there seems to be no way. He works in things we cannot see. He will make a way for me. He will be my God. Hold me close, put it to his side. What's the way, Steph, Sister Denise? With something here for you, new day. With love and what?
Love and strength.
Love and strength for each new day. God will make a way. God will make a way. Well, that song ministered to me. Whoa, it ministers to me. Amen. So the Holy Spirit is working, and I believe that God has what? Angels as what? Ministering spirits sent forth to minister to those who would be what? Heirs of what? Salvation. All right, so the angels are interested, and who else is interested? Amen. There are only two other classes of people left.
The devil.
Is the devil interested in the law?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
He has what? Blinded what? The eyes of those that do not what? Believe. Okay, why is the devil so interested in the laws? So what, brother?
Yeah, kicked out of heaven.
He got kicked out of heaven, so he's mad at everybody.
That's right.
For one reason, he got kicked out of heaven, and he's mad at everybody. He wants everybody to be kicked out too, lost. All right. And the Bible says that as soon as the sower sows the word, the devil comes immediately and does what? Snatch it out. You don't want people what? To receive the word of God. All right. So the devil is now, what about down in hell, what makes you know the devil is interested in the lost that day?
Let me tell you in our lesson about Lazarus.
Yeah, Lazarus. Okay, the account down in hell, Lazarus and the rich man. So the rich man was concerned about what? People are concerned about hell and about the loss in hell, but that proved that. The rich man was concerned about his lost what?
Brothers.
His lost brothers. So people in hell are what? Concerned, right? And he wanted somebody to be sent back into what? Real life. So that they could what? Testify to his brothers. Mm-hmm. To not to come to a place of what?
Torment.
All right, so people in hell are concerned about the loss. It seems like there's only one class of people left. And these are what? Human beings. And it seems like we're the only ones that can what? Do something about it. And the only one as a whole that really do not what specifically focus on the law. Anybody remember the little story that was told in that story in that chapter about the man, the preacher that was so mechanical? You know, just like Paul was describing his fellow laborers. Okay.
Page 16?
Okay.
Where the minister was reading the last
rites. Yes, right. Okay, everybody can tell that? I read it.
There is a story of a minister reading the last rites to a convicted criminal that was to be hanged. Mm-hmm. Because of the cold, callous, heartless, and nonchalant manner the last rite was ministered, the condemned criminal made this remark mm-hmm. to the minister mm-hmm. after hearing about his horrible fate. If I were a Christian and I knew the horrible destiny of sinners after they died like you do, mm-hmm. I would be willing to crawl from the west coast to the east coast mm-hmm. on my knees, on glass, to save one sinner from a place of torment like you described. That indeed was a sad observation of the dying criminal.
Mm-hmm. Any comments on that?
It just seemed like the minister was doing something wrong. You know, he probably done many times. It was like next, just, and that he didn't, from the account, mm-hmm. it didn't seem like his heart was in it. And that he didn't have any compassion on the criminal. It was like, that what I get from it is like the minister was like, okay, you've done something to deserve this, so let's just get this over with. Mm-hmm. And he didn't have any compassion on the criminal. Mm-hmm.
Okay, now how does that relate to us today? Let's break it down. How does it relate to us today? How could it relate, or how does it relate?
Well, sometimes we see people in certain situations. When I say we, I mean probably not people here, mm-hmm. but some Christians see people in certain situations, and they can help, and they can have compassion on them to help them, but they're observation of their thing is, well, they are in that position because of what they did. So they made, like our grandparents used to tell us, if you make your bed, you lay in. You know, that kind of thing, without having compassion that were it not for the will of God, we could be where those people are. But just, you know, like compassion, well, they're there, you know. It had to be something they did to be in that position. And often we don't move our hands to help them.
Okay.
So it's a material kind of thing.
Right.
I'd like, we got just 15 minutes left, to have hear a little discussion about, we are talking about having God's interest in heart and us reaching out. A little discussion on how we have already established that everybody is different. God has gifted each one of us with different abilities. Mm-hmm. In terms of reaching out, the just the kind of how-tos. I know you got it written in your book, that little book there. But just a brief discussion on the how-tos. You know, you mentioned earlier about going out, and you mentioned about the club. You know, some people, as I said earlier, some people can go there and be very effective, and they don't have to be there and not tainted by that. There are some people that maybe came out of that, they don't need to step their foot back in there again, because they would just fall, you know, they would be tainted. Just some discussion on the various abilities that God has given us, how we can go about doing that, you know, reaching the lost, that it's not one method that's cut and dry, that you have to do it this way, that if you don't do it this way, you're not effective. I just like to have some discussion.
Okay, everybody get the question.
Well, just a discussion.
All right, Sister Hill wants to coordinate that discussion. She wants to coordinate that discussion. Okay, come on, stand up.
Well, no, somebody can volunteer, like, you know, different. Like, okay. Sister Irene's good at talking. She had all those kinds of questions. Okay, like, she may reach a person, you know, reach out, because God has given her certain gifts, and give me. So, I shouldn't be expected to reach out in the same way that she does. Mm-hmm. You know, she may have, that's what I say, some discussion on that.
Okay.
Well, I have showed the house today. I'm one of the persons that I showed it to. Went through some dramatic things. And she was a young lady, a daughter of the lady. And I just felt, I told her I'm just kind of a blunt person. And the things that you're going through, don't let them change you to get off your path what God has for you. Because some things can happen in our lives that are bad and not our fault. But we can still, the enemy will make us think through the next thing. You know, and I just remind them, you still want to be the person God called you to be. And protect yourself so that they won't hinder you. And she started crying. I mean, I was about to cry too, but I just felt bad to tell her.
So you knew she was a Christian? Or was she?
Well, I know her family is a Christian. I mean, I don't know her family. I just happened to know some of her family when I met them. And I know she was going through some things, so they shared with me. But I just know that sometimes you need to hear it from not just your mom, but somebody else, a stranger you don't even know, to let you know that it's going to be all right. With God on your side, you can be all that and then some. You know, because sometimes when situations come across in our lives that are negative, it makes me feel like you're not good enough or you're not worthy, even if it's not your fault. So I just come to it, and like I said, I know it touched her because I asked that tear. You know, her mother said she kind of missed it 3 days, something similar to her. You know, it was just confirmation.
So when you were talking to this lady, did you think consciously or unconsciously, I really need to share the word with her. I really need to share the word with her. Or was it an automatic thing that it just in your conversation that ensued that came out? How was it?
I guess a little bit of both, because I am naturally a talker. Mm-hmm. But I also believe your words need to be a blessing to people. And like I said, I just felt the boldness was supposed to happen at that time. And like I said, her reaction made me feel like it was God using me. It really wasn't about me. I just did what I felt to be obedient.
Okay, that's good. That's good.
That is good. Now, somebody else may not.
Okay, Sister Dorothy, Okay.
I was just going to say, my experience was conscious. A classmate of mine, I got word that she had cancer. Mm-hmm. And we've been kind of keeping in contact with each other. Well, when I called her, I just wanted to talk. What I asked her was, what is it you want me to pray for? She was asking people for prayer, but I wanted her to be specific. And her response was, I want strength. I said, drink? I said, now you know he heals. Mm-hmm. And so from there, we have started like a little Bible study. It's just so informal. It's just no big deal at all. It's just that we call each other every morning around 7:30, and we share scripture. And she just told me that from the call. And what I'm trying to say is mine was conscious. I consciously mm-hmm. had scripture on my mind. Mm-hmm. I consciously had prayer on my mind. Mm-hmm. I consciously knew that she was scared. This is something she's never gone through before, so I consciously had scriptures and she is saved, but she was scared, and so mine was just totally conscious. I knew the scriptures, I knew what words to pray, and so she told me, from this little bit of time we've had together, that her faith has really increased just from our little conversations.
Mm-hmm. How has that impacted you, made you feel better? Strengthen you, I know that she's been strengthened. And as you share with her.
Mm. Pastor, I have to say, I haven't, quote, felt anything. I just know mm-hmm. from our you teaching us that when you're helping someone else, mm-hmm. You're building your own self up. So I, like I said, nothing has necessarily changed with me, mm-hmm. but I know. Mm-hmm. From this, that I'm being blessed.
Right. Okay. All right, enough discussion? You might need to say something for us.
Well, I came with the question. I even told you after I read it.
Okay.
After I read it. I don't know. I guess I felt challenged by, I think, in the last part about Christians. Christians are the least that have concern. And I said, well, I guess I challenge that. Mm-hmm. And so I was going to ask, and it's similar to what Sister Hill asked, what does it look like? Mm-hmm. When you say that, mm-hmm. what does that look like? Because we're all in different environments. Mm-hmm. And I mean, in my environment, and then just day to day, and the people I encounter, I've been more open, and you know, you figure out, and you know where you're supposed to be. When it's appropriate to talk mm-hmm. religion, if you will. Mm-hmm. So we pass prayers to each other. Mm-hmm. You know, we share books and Stormy, can't think of the last name. But, you know, praying for right. These are young people, younger. I'm kind of the old person on the block. But young people, children, and, you know, other cares of life. And so... So to me, that's what that looks like. And to you, that's what that looks like, because you have the latitude to, you know, meet and encounter other people. And so, again, I guess I thought, I don't know if I think that Christians don't necessarily care. It just looks different to different people of where you are in your season, or... I don't know if I...
Are your chat times of opportunity?
Yeah, so I guess that was what I wanted to hear, was what do you call that? What do you mean?
Well, I think that we said the phrase that very carefully, the majority Christians, of course, we know a lot of times Christians are...
a lot of things.
Yeah,
and I think that, like, with Sister Deborah's, with your background, and with a lot of our backgrounds in here, I think that to say this, it may not necessarily be that we're not, mm-hmm. but Christendom as a whole, I think you could say that a lot of people are not interested in the things of God. And I think that's because a lot of times people are not taught that they should be. Mm-hmm. You know, they've come up in an environment. And I have to say, that's how I grew up. I grew up in a Baptist church, and we were not told that you had to do these things. It was just after I received the Lord that it was like, oh, okay, it was an awakening for me. So I think that you have a lot of people operating in darkness that they don't know that, not necessarily. And I'm glad you brought that up, Sister Deborah, because... But I was sitting here thinking that, you know, you have some people, that's why I said everybody's so different. Some people that And I'll make this real quick. Some people really, really enjoy going out, canvassing, meeting people, knocking on doors, and, you know, that's their niche. There are other people in here, it's like, no, I don't want to hit knock on anybody's door. And I always say, you bloom where you planted. What I mean by that is the environment where you are, your work and your sharing. Okay, for me, it's very more comfortable for me when I'm out. I don't know, people just talk to me. You know, people that I don't know, they just come up and start talking. Yeah, is that real people? They can be white, any color. They just start talking to me, and it's like, you know, hey, fine. It does not matter. And people start sharing with me, and people have just opened up to me and told me their life story, and I've never seen them before. That gives me an opportunity to begin to share with them, because I know one thing I have, and I don't have many talents, but one is I'm a good listener. And when I think this is why people are able to share, because I listen to what people say and I give them my undivided attention, and I can share there. That's me. Now, I may not be like Sister Pearl. Sister Pearl may not be that kind of person. Mm-hmm. But whatever she is, let her do what she feels comfortable at doing. And when we say going out, and everybody may not be able to go out. If you're in a situation where you can't go out. Mm-hmm. And here again, I get back to bloom where you're planted. Mm-hmm. I mean, wherever you are, that's what you do. And whatever God's has gifted you with, your talents and your abilities, that's what you use to reach out with. It's no cookie cutter, one size fit all.
Everybody's spoken well. And we also have to keep in mind, when Paul was speaking to the last days, and he was speaking about the church, he was saying the last days, fearless times will come. Is that right? Mm-hmm. Men would become. This one also that in the last days. This is 2 Timothy 3. For men shall be lovers of their own selves. Covetous, boasters, you know, proud.
Wait a minute, 3 plus.
3 verses 1 on the second
one.
Okay. Covetous, boasters, proud, blasphemous, and disobedient to parents, unholy, unthankful, unholy, without natural affection, false accusers, incontinent, fears, despising the holy, that they're traitors, heady, high-minded, lovers of pleasures, and lovers of God, having a form of godliness, but denying the power thereof. So we have to also keep in mind that the last day church, we are the Laodicea church, and that you're going to find a whole lot of this lukewarmness, right? I would say that the Laodicean church is going to be, neither what? Hot or cold, because they are not hot or cold, then God said he was going to what?
Spear
my mouth. So we have to keep in mind that although everybody might not be in the same category, but many of the Laodicean members of the church, they're going to really, the Bible says, because iniquity shall abound, the love of many shall what?
Wax
cold. So we have to, you know, get the balance on that. And so we have to face the reality that we are dealing with lukewarmness in the church today too. And we have to really begin to exhort people, continue to exhort them, and to pray and to admonish people.
So we can conclude that, mm-hmm. to say the humans are not interested, the Christians are not interested, that qualify that to say some people are not, and that maybe we can be more diligent in it, but mm-hmm. that it's not that we're not interested, that we just maybe should make a more concerted effort.
Mm-hmm. Okay, we were saying Christians as a whole, mm-hmm. and that's what he was trying to articulate.
I just wanted a clarification, and I just.
Christians as a whole, so, you know, who are the, you know, we just have to take personal inventory. Okay, a couple of things we need to do. Sister Irene is going to help us with the